Hello. Hi. What's up? What's good? Notice that greeting just now? Started with hello, went to hey, went to what's good, what's up, and then a head nod. That is actually what's happened with our greetings. But they actually derive themselves from an original hello greeting that initially meant health to you. Everyone say health to you. Health to you then went to hello, which went to hey, which went to what's up, which went to what's good, which went to the head nod, right? The hated head nod, just I'm too cool for school. That's kind of what's happened with greetings. It went from health to you to head nods. Now, Paul in this text in Philippians is going to give a greeting. It's better than health to you. I would argue it's even better than what Boaz said, God be with you, because God is with you. This is one of the greatest greetings of all. And we're going to learn the power of greetings, because to Paul, when he would greet people, it wasn't just like a closing benediction or prefatory introduction remarks. To Paul, when he greeted people, he was a Hebrew of Hebrews, he says. He was Jewish in his bones. The Hebrew-Israeli nationality sunk into his gut. He was a Jewish rabbi. He was a Hebrew. So when he spoke, it wasn't just, hey, what's good, what's up? When he was speaking a greeting, he was acting as a priest, channeling and funneling blessing from God to people, kind of like a FedEx package delivery where you ring the doorbell, ding dong, who's there? Grace and peace, FedEx delivery from who? From God. This wasn't coming from him. Paul would greet and bless the church at Philippi from God himself as a priestly messenger. We don't use the word priests enough in the church today, and here's why. Because as a result of Martin Luther in concert with Gutenberg Printing Press spreading his 95 Theses message, evangelicalism has departed so far from the Catholic Church that the word priest is taboo. It's a hamartia, it's anathema to a lot of people. But the Catholic Church, where they didn't get it wrong, is using priests. Where I would argue against what they use is one priest. Oh, that guy's a priest, that guy's not. Same with Eastern Orthodoxy. Eastern Orthodoxy, you can have bearded priests and they marry over in the East. That's where their sort of outpost for Rome is as an alternative. But then if you look at, you know, the Roman Catholic Church, it has, oh, you have this priest, this guy's a priest and this guy isn't. But the Bible actually uses in the New Testament, not just Aaron, but in the New Testament, it uses the words priest a lot. Of course, some of my favorite authors like G.K. Chesterton and Tolkien were Catholic, and Thomas Aquinas, etc. But what I want to say is bringing back the idea of priesthood, only it's not priest Ben. It's not just priest Aaron or Jerry. You are all a royal priesthood. We're all priests. What does that mean? We speak to God for the people and we speak to the people for God. We are representatives of God channeling the words of God to other people, and we get to stand in the gap for others just like a pontifex. That's the Latin word for priest means. It means a bridge builder. We get to bridge the gap. We are all priests, not just one person, all of us. Are you picking up what I'm throwing down? So when Paul spoke, it was a blessing that would actually take effect in people's lives, and that's how he would greet as a priestly blessing. Right now, we're gonna need this blessing because our culture is very stressed. You know, during the holidays, 88% of people are stressed. Finances, meeting with family members that bring up the same mistake you made over and over again every year, perhaps. That family member from Alabama, I can use that as an example because I don't know anybody from Alabama. But basically, you're gonna need this greeting that he's gonna give. Economically, I was reading in the news this morning before church that there's a stimulus package that they're trying to pass across the aisle through the House of Congress tonight before the government shuts down, of a $900 billion stimulus package. Yet another one just pulling from the Federal Reserve, and people are stressed out. Will I get my money? About a third of that is going to small businesses. The Republicans want $5 billion to private schools. The Democrats want $2.5 billion. And you say, is this even gonna work? Are they gonna be able to work together? Because both Democrats and Republicans know a stimulus package has to pass before the government shuts down, before tonight. Can we do this? And a lot of people are stressed financially, they're stressed about relationships during the holidays, we are going to need this blessing that Paul is going to speak. But before we get into that, I want to kind of catch you up on where we left off in Philippians. We started this book last week. So I've taken you personally through verse by verse through Philemon. I've taken you verse by verse through 3 John, taken you verse by verse through Ephesians. Last week took you verse by verse through the whole book of Jonah. Now we're going verse by verse through the book of Philippians. And we started last Monday. So turn with me to Philippians chapter 1, if you would. Verse 1. Now, just so you know, this is one of the few letters wherein Paul does not refer to himself as an apostle. Now, he does in the church of to the church of Thessalonica, when he writes to the Thessalonians, he doesn't call himself an apostle. But this is the only other letter where he doesn't call himself an apostle. This and his letters to the Thessalonians. Other than that, he always called himself an apostle. Why? Because Paul didn't mention the word sin once in Philippians because this was a really good church. Like, he probably had his best relationship out of any other church with the church at Philippi. So he didn't need to flout or flaunt or throw around as weight his political authority or his apostolic authority. Apostoline means the sent one. He didn't need to say, I'm an apostle, listen to me, like he did with Corinth when, you know, a guy's getting drunk on communion wine, other people are hoarding communion bread at the expense of the poor, and another guy in the church is sleeping with his dad's wife. Like, it was pretty messed up, and then was delivered to the synagogue of Satan. He had to throw around his apostolic authority. In fact, he specifically gave his resume to show, I am an authoritative apostle. But you know your relationship is strained with your kid if you're like, I am your father, listen to what I say, right? You don't have to remind a person of that if there's a good relationship there. In the same way, Paul didn't have to remind the church at Philippi, I am an apostle. Why? Because he was writing as a friend to other friends, just as he did to the church at Thessalonica. Now, Philippi was a Roman colony, as we learned last week. It was a Rome away from Rome. It was a hot Mediterranean climate. Of course, it started in Acts 16, where there was a demon-possessed slave girl that annoyed Paul. Paul delivered her of the evil spirit and her oracular fortune-telling, foreboding predispositions and abilities. He also saved a suicidal parole officer. What must we do to be saved? Believe on the Kyrios, Jesus Christ, and you and your whole house shall be saved. So they have a family in Philippi that took Paul and Silas in, and they were saved. Then you had, of course, in that text at the beginning, Paul had a Macedonian man vision. Some think it was Alexander the Great who was Macedonian because Paul followed geographically in the footsteps of Alexander the Great when he conquered territory, not for Macedon like Alexander, but for the kingdom of God as Paul the Apostle. What happened with Paul is he sees a Macedonian man, goes to Philippi, and he probably expects to see a man. Visions are sometimes different, but always better than we think when they come from God over our life, because he finds women next to a river and he baptizes them. One of them was named Lydia, who was a seller of purple. And if you sold purple back then, you were very wealthy because you would actually get the purple dye from shellfish off the coast of Thessalonica. So she was like a wealthy tycoon businesswoman making purple dye from shellfish off the coast of Thessalonica. That's who Paul's working with, a businesswoman who's a rich, wealthy mover and shaker, business professional tycoon. Then you, a titan of industry. Then you have a suicidal parole officer. And then you have a demon-possessed girl. And Paul is working with all of them and bringing them into the church. At no other time or place in the ancient Near East, in Paul's generation, would you see these three people together. Yet the gospel brings them all together. And that's how the church of Philippi started. And 10, 11, or 12 years, he wrote it somewhere between AD 60 and AD 62, he wrote the book to Philippi, to the Philippians, 800 miles away from Rome, because one of their members, Epaphroditus, sent him a gift that saved his life when he was in prison because there was no Roman cafeteria, reruns of 80s TV shows, or weightlifting. Like, you were stuck in prison. You could die. You had to rely on your friends and family for clothing, for water, and food. Epaphroditus gave Paul a gift from the church of Philippi. So Philippians is a glorified thank you letter, but there's a lot more in it besides. Now, what's fascinating is, just like Goshen was an Israeli territory within Egypt, just as an outpost represents the greater vision of a kingdom, so too Philippi is a colony that was put in the 800 miles away from Rome. It was put in place to set up Roman soldiers who would Romanize the culture around it. Just quick recap. And basically, it was a hot Mediterranean climate. You'd have olive trees, you'd have rocks, you'd have flowers. You had a bunch of people living there in the middle of the city. You had a temple devoted to the imperial cult propaganda of Caesar, saying he had godhood and you should worship him. That's what the Latin inscriptions on the buildings. It was a Rome away from Rome. So when Paul writes the Philippians in chapter 1, verse 27, and then again in chapter 3, verse 20, that your conversation or citizenship is in heaven, he was playing on the whole Roman colony idea. Romans are there. Listen, the Roman colony is in Philippi to Romanize the Macedonia area in the northern tip of Greece, where Philippi was, and you are here put on earth to heavenize the world as a colony of heaven. Because the verb form of live as citizens is equated with the noun form, is literally transliterated into the noun form of you are a colony of heaven. So when Paul says twice in this book to live as citizens of heaven, that's the verb form of you are a colony of heaven. So just as the Philippians were living in a colony that was to Romanize the city and the culture around it, to bring Roman culture, Roman law, Roman theater, Roman dance, Roman justice, Roman literature to the area around it, so too, Paul says, you are still on this earth, on earth as it is in heaven, to heavenize the world, to spread the culture of heaven to your corner of the earth. And this is subversive and dangerous writing because he is preaching an alternative gospel. The original gospel was when a king was born or Rome won a victory, you would preach the gospel, the good news, the king was born. Paul preaches an alternative gospel that Jesus is actually the king, not Caesar, which in the next chapter, Acts 17, got him in trouble because they were saying he preaches about another king who's not Caesar, King Jesus. Not only that, he's preaching an alternative colony. We are a colony of heaven, not just a colony of Rome away from Rome. Are you picking up what I'm throwing down? That's a quick recap. Okay. I'll take a quick breath. Let's go to verse 1 of Philippians, verse 1, where we studied verse 1 last Monday. I just want to read it again with you real quick. Paul and Timotheus. Timothy was not the co-author, but he was like kind of shadowing Paul, helping him out in ministry, similar to an intern, an apprentice. The servants of Jesus Christ. That word servants is douloi in Greek, and it was literally used of prophets, and it was the highest title of honor. It was used of slaves. But because of the African slave trade and those horrors, translators have been hesitant to translate that as slaves, but that's actually what it means, douloi or slaves. Now, servants of God, this was a phrase used by Joshua, of Joshua, everyone say Joshua. Moses, everyone say Moses. David, everyone say David. This was a high title of honor, douloi or doulos. And you, if you were a doulos, you belonged to your owner. You were the property of your owner. You weren't quite subhuman like how the horrible American slavery existed before during the Civil War under the sort of Jefferson Davis Jim Crow regime. We're talking about not quite that bad of slavery, but you were still somebody's property. So Paul's saying, I'm the property of who? Jesus Christos. Servants of Jesus Christos, which is the Greek transliteration of the Hebrew Mashiach. It can be translated literally Christ, Messiah, King, or King of the World. Those are the four ways to translate it. So do you see how this is already dangerous, edgy, and subversive? You're like, Paul's writing to the King of the World, Jesus. Who's the King of the World at the time? Nero. We believe that Nero was on the throne when Paul wrote this. And his two favorite titles for himself were Lord and Savior. So what does Paul do? He likes to call Jesus Lord and Savior, right? This is subversive. This is dangerous. This is edgy. So a lot of times you read this, you're like, so much Christianese. I'm the mayor of Yonsville. But what you have to remember is this is so much more dangerous and subversive than that. So servants of Jesus Christos, the King of the World, to not only the King of Israel, but the ruler, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi. Saints is hagios. In the Old Testament, hagios was translated as holy. It was used of the tithe, which was a tenth of the produce that was given as an offering in the temple or the tabernacle, etc., or as Abraham gave a tithe to Melchizedek. That tenth is holy, hagios. It means separated from all the rest of the other 90% produce. Hagios was also used of priests who were different from ordinary men, or the Holy of Holies in the Old Testament, which was different from all other buildings and every other part and parcel of the Old Testament temple. Hagios meant different. It meant set apart. So he's saying you are hagios, you are different, you are set apart, just as the Jews were set apart from all the other nations as a theocracy until they demanded to be like all the other nations that have Saul as a king. They released their hagios holiness. Hagios simply means set apart. It means different. means you're different. To all those who are different, set apart in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus, he uses that phrase over and over again. What does it mean? Like a fish is in the sea, like a bird is in the air, like a root is in the soil, so too you are in the Christ dimension. I love this. With the bishops, now that word episkopos in the Greek is where we get the word episcopalian and its synonym presbyter, which is where we get the word presbyterian. It literally means overseer. It's the same thing as elders. And deacons, diakonos is the word in Greek, and it was used of those who serve justice in the church. You know what? This church, we're very passionate about helping the homeless. We're very passionate about helping those in need. We're very passionate about giving food as a church to those who are hungry, giving to orphans when they're in need, taking care of them through our orphanage in Mexico. Why? Because diakonos, that was the word used for deacon, and it meant servant. So just as Paul and Timothy call themselves douloi or doulos, that means servants or slaves, so too diakonos means servants. You can find them established all the way back in Acts 6 when they needed to help the Hellenized and the Jewish women come together and eat food so nobody was neglected. They were serving justice in the church, which meant they were feeding the hungry. That's what a deacon would do. He would practically help feed the hungry and serve justice to the church, diakonos. So that's verse 1. That's how far we got last Monday night. You guys hanging in there so far, we're hitting the ground running. Yes, are you guys awake? You're doing good? Smile and nod, people. Smile and nod. Okay, now let's get to verse 2. Are you ready? We're gonna cover all of verse 2 today. Philippians, I am so stoked about this verse. I can't wait. Philippians 1 verse 2, we had fun first service. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you just to look up from your Bible, close your eyes if you want. Let me read these first two verses again, because we got to remember we're in a flow. We're in a flow. This is a letter. We're eavesdropping on Paul's mail to the church at Philippi. Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi with the bishops and deacons, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Did you know that Paul always closed his letters, every one of them, with grace? As we'll see in a moment, he opened them with grace, but grace is not just the starting point, it's the ending point, it's the only point. It's how he started every letter, it's how he ended every letter, with grace. We're gonna get into that a little bit more, but grace be unto you in peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. We need grace and peace in this time. We're coming into the holidays. That's what we need. Can I speak that priestly blessing over you? This isn't just, hey, I'm out of here, or hey, here's the way of saying what's good. This is, let me speak this over you. Grace and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace. We need that. I've never seen the nation more divided. I wasn't around during Vietnam with the hippies and Nixon fans at each other's throats. I wasn't around during the Civil War, but man, we're divided right now. There's not a lot of grace out there, is there? Not a lot of peace in here, is there? There's a lot of gracelessness on social media. There's a lack of peace everywhere. Isn't this, maybe this verse can change the world. Maybe this verse, this simple greeting, which is not just a greeting, it's a blessing. Like kind of like when Jacob would bless his children and he would predict what would happen with them. Sounds kind of Freudian, but he prophesied over them as a fatherly patriarchal blessing. Let me speak this blessing over you. May Applegators be known. May Hope Generators be known. If you're listening on the radio, may K Applegators be known as people of grace and peace. We're grace and peace people. On social media, you're a grace and peace person. How's that sound? On Facebook, you're a grace and peace person. How does that sound? In your emails, you're a grace and peace person. How does that sound? What if you open, that was dead silent right there. I think some conviction just happened. What if every email you sent, especially when you're in a heat, you started with grace and peace? A lot of cognitive dissonance, hypocritos. You'd feel like a hypocrite if you're gonna send the fiery one. And I am the chief of sinners here. I have a short wick on my temper, but grace and peace, that's what's spoken over us. That's the power that enters into our lives. We need it during the holidays. Do you know where Thanksgiving came from? We just got off Thanksgiving a few weeks ago. Thanksgiving actually came from the Civil War. It was initiated under Abraham Lincoln's leadership during the Civil War. When a nation was torn apart, they realized we have to stop and give thanks. That's what we have to do. We need to stop and say thank you for grace. Thank you for peace. We need to stop and give thanks again. Grace and peace. You know, I love that we're starting Philippians during Christmas. Joy to the world! When it says, and we're going to look at this Christmas Eve, when it says glad tidings of great joy, the word great is mega. It's literally where we get the word mega, like Megatron, Transformers, mega joy. This is known as the joy epistle. Joy is found 16 times, or depending on how you count it, 19 times in these four chapters. 19 times, either the word joy or the verb form, which is to rejoice. So when you see the word rejoice, that's just the verb of joy. So you have the indicative imperative. That's how Paul writes his letters, the indicative imperative. He tells you who you are, indicates who you are in the Lord, and then he gives an imperative of what you're supposed to do. And we'll see, that's kind of how Paul did Ephesians. There's credenda and agenda. There's telling you your identity, then giving you your instruction, activity. But Paul the apostle here, he writes this book on joy. Joy, joy, joy. Joy is the verb for, joy is the noun form of the verb rejoice. Rejoice, 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 as he writes from a prison cell. And he opens up this letter with not just a greeting, but a priestly blessing. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to share with you something from my heart. For many years, I did not have peace. And I didn't tap into the full grace that was available to me. For many years, even working here, for my first years working here, I didn't have any friends. I didn't have a lot of peace. I was anxious, suicidal. I've shared that, I won't rehash my story, but very depressed. And then God showed me that the reality of our life should be marked by hope, by grace, and by peace. I love that this church, decade after decade, we've learned grace. We're a grace people. And learning this has changed my life so much so that I believe we can cure our generation of this depression problem, this suicide problem. If we send some grace and peace winging people's way, if we work at this thing, I think we can change the zeitgeist of our culture. I've been so fortunate. I remember when I was 17 years old, God showed me some stuff I'm doing right now where I get to spread this hope all over, spread his message all over. And that's what I've been able to do the past few, I'm going to show you a video from this past season of just, even during COVID, a lot of it, just going on these book tours. I know it sounds like, oh, that's glamour, but it's so fulfilling to me to just see colonies. There weren't many colonies in the Roman Empire. There were only a few, like Philippi, but what they did is they kept the nation conquered, because Alexander would conquer, and a bunch of these city-states could defeat armies, but they couldn't keep the people in line because they didn't have colonies. The colonies would make sure that 800 miles away, even in Philippi, you're going to act Roman because you have a bunch of retired veteran Roman soldiers that live there. In the same way, I just love creating outposts for the kingdom of God everywhere I go. Just everywhere I go, I want to spread grace, peace, and hope vibes winging people's way. I want to show you just kind of what I've been up to recently in this video that Jeremy made. He released it this morning, so last minute I'm like, hey, let's play this for Sunday morning service. So let's just rejoice in what God's doing and spreading grace, peace, and hope to our generation. We will not be the mope generation. We will be the hope generation. The reason I live on airplanes is because it's been on my heart to travel and give people from all topographical regions hope in droves. There's nothing like speaking to a generation, spreading joy galore, and winning back the hopeless generation to a sense of the possible. Meeting thousands of individuals one by one during book signings has shown me the thirst people have for hope. Optimisfits, igniting a fierce rebellion against hopelessness, and flirting with darkness, building hope in the face of depression, has been spreading like a flame untamed. I have the cure to depression, so I'm living out of a suitcase to spread this message all over. Speaking to flocks of people to build a hope generation and arm them to the teeth with a spiritual arsenal. But I want to not just speak the message, but live it. Along with speaking, I want to make time for friends, getting filled up with hope. From ice skating to listening to reggae on the beach at twilight, my friends keep me recharged
It used to be when I would speak, I had no time for joyful friends, but now I do. Because fun and impact need not be separate. In fact, the more joyful we are, the more healthy and energized we will be while providing a model for our generation, putting wheels on our hope message. It's a mighty combo when friends and purpose go hand in hand.
God has been so good. And I share that with you to show we're changing our generation. We're doing it. We're doing it by the grace and peace of God animating us. And God wants to bless you. He does. He doesn't want you just to white knuckle it through your whole life. Like, God is graceless and he won't give me peace. No. Let me ask you, are you enjoying life with God? Because it should be fun. Oh, it gets hard, but we even love the suffering. Because it's like, I love when I'm with my friends. One of those was Benil. He's a UFC fighter. Like, the mindset is like, how much can we suffer in the next hour and a half? You know, like, even the bad stuff, we glory in tribulation. We're like, let's not masochist, but like, let's be warriors. And that was my intro. We gotta hurry. You guys doing okay? Okay. Grace and peace. We need grace and peace. The average couple has 7 arguments during the holidays. Not a lot of grace and peace. The average couple has 7 arguments during the holidays. Some of you couples are like, it's only December 20-something, and I wish we could lower our arguments to that number. 42% of people unbutton their pants after a holiday meal. Speaking of Thanksgiving and Christmas, I don't know how they do these studies, but 42% of people unbutton their pants after a holiday meal. I'm guessing the other 58% have their buttons fly off automatically. But this is indeed the joy epistle. And 88% of people, as I mentioned, they're stressed during the holidays. The world has bad news. The word has good news. I want you to say that with me. Say it with me. The world has bad news. The word has good news. Mega joy. Great, glad tidings of great joy. By the way, I'm going to continue to write about this because I just finished writing 2 more books. God like dropped all this stuff in my head and I'm like, I just finished 2 more books, which I'm excited about. Those are coming. Like, didn't you just come out with one? Yes, but we got to keep going. Here's what's crazy. Paul's writing this book. It's all about joy. That's what Philippians is all about. It's all about joy. And you could just see Paul brimming over with inspiration. It's been said that light makes white for writers, which means that if you're filled with light and you're happy, you're just going to have a white screen and a white page and you're not going to be creative because creativity comes from inner turmoil. And I think that's partly true, sort of, but not really. Because at the same time, Paul the Apostle, he's in tribulation, but he's writing from a place of darkness, a prison cell, and yet he's brimming over with joy. And what's really interesting is, so this idea that light writes white, I mean, you just have a white page. In Paul's case, it was actually kind of different. He's like, I'm going to be creative from a place of joy. This is a creative epistle. It's sort of the propizio, the excursio, the proposition, the Roman rhetoric that he's using in this letter. Only 15% of the Roman Empire were literate in that they could read or write, but almost everyone knew rhetoric, how to speak well. Like, this is a brilliant letter, and yet Paul is doing this from a place of joy, even though his outward circumstances are hard. Now, what's interesting is this book almost didn't get written. Oh, the Holy Spirit knew it would. This book almost didn't get written, because guess what? Philippi, theologians argue that it was probably his best relationship with any church was with Philippi. They gave to him in Rome, Thessalonica, Corinth. No other church financially gave to him. He was about to starve to death. The Philippian church saved him by giving him a gift. But Paul was a tent maker, like he didn't want to receive money from churches. The only church he received money from is Philippians. That's it. The only church he received money from was the church at Philippi. This was his best relationship. An amazing book, a book of joy. Tambo, you read it every single day. It's a book of joy. That's why you're so joyful in part. But what's fascinating is this. Philippi was a rebound church. Paul was wanting to go to Troas. He tried to go to Bithynia. The Holy Spirit forbade him. But then he follows the Macedonian man and ends up in Philippi. It wasn't on his calendar. Some of the best things come from spontaneous actions led by the Holy Spirit that are not on your iCal. This was a rebound church. He didn't even intend to go there. It was because all the other doors were closing. Isn't that interesting? When plan A doesn't work out, there's 20-some other letters in the alphabet. How many? 20? Are there 26 letters? So there's 25 other letters in the alphabet if plan A doesn't work out. And this ended up being his best church. Isn't that great? Like when the Holy Spirit forbids you to go through doors you really want to open, God's like, I'm going to do a plan B, C, or D, but this is actually going to be your best plan of all. And Philippi ended up being the best church he started, and it was a rebound church. Isn't that cool? Grace and peace. Hello. Hi. What's up? What's good? Grace and peace. We awake? Okay, good. Let's read it one more time. So good. Let's dive into it. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, Philippians 1:2. Now notice, he says grace and peace not from Paul. Remember, he's a FedEx delivery man being dispatched by God. This is from God to Philippi. I'm just a messenger boy. I just deliver the mail. I just deliver the mail. And what great mail it was. Here was a church that was going to be encouraged in joy, this thank you letter. This wasn't a church that looked like it got baptized in lemon juice or prune juice. They didn't have expressions that looked like they ate bad Chinese food. No, you can laugh. You're allowed. I give you permission. This is a church that's joyful. I think of this church. I think of Applegate. I love how much joy you guys exude and emanate. This is a letter from God through Paul to Philippi. That's what he says. Grace and peace unto you from God. So what's specifically from God is the grace and peace salutation, grace and peace. Now here's the thing. If he just stopped at grace and peace from God, period, in verse 2, you would say in a Greco-Roman society with a pantheon of deities and divinities, you would say, which one? Grace and peace from God, great. Which one? From Zeus? From Asclepius, the god of medicine? From Poseidon, the god of the sea? From Caesar? From Augustus? From Nero? Like, which god? So notice, he doesn't just say from God, he says from God the Father. Now let's stop there for a moment. The Father. Now, I was studying this book about Alexander the Great, and his biographer made an argument, Agnes Seville, that he was the first person to introduce to the world not only the brotherhood of man, which he was really attempting to accomplish, he was the first to introduce the world specifically to God as Father. But how Alexander represented God as Father, he was called the son of Ammon, the son of Zeus. Did he really believe that? He said, oh, I've spilled mortal ichor. This blood is not divine. Like, did he really believe that? Was it PR purposes? The world may never know. I think he partially believed that he was the son of a god. And then there's an argument made. Well, no, the Israelis, they believe that God is a father. After all, it says he is a father to the fatherless. He's the father of Israel. And then, of course, you had Zeus, who was Deus Pater. That's what the name means. God the Father. Deus, God, Pater, paternal, father, Deus, divinity, God the Father. But the way that these contexts were bouncing around in this echo chamber of God as Father, it wasn't like what Jesus did. He was the first person to really introduce to men and women the idea that God is daddy, that he's Abba, that he's not just a paternal, like he made everybody, so why don't you all get along as brothers? It's even deeper than that. I'm your daddy. I'm your Abba. He's the first person to really introduce the intimate fatherhood of God and make that his emphasis. So when Paul calls God the Father, you immediately think, okay, he's a Hebrew rabbi because the Israelis referred to God as Father a little bit. But more than that, he's a follower of the sect of the Nazarene, the way. He's in this subversive movement of Jesus followers that no wonder he's in prison he's writing Jesus is Kyrios, not Caesar. Kyrios means Lord. But when Paul says from God the Father, you immediately know, okay, oh, he's one of those Christ folk, because that was what Jesus did. Over and over again, Jesus addresses God as Father. So he's setting the creator God apart from the Greco-Roman pantheon of divinities and deities, from God the Father. You need to be specific about who you're praying to, God the Father. And from the Lord Jesus Christ, he says at the end of verse 2. Now, the Lord is such an interesting phrase. Don't just yawn at this. I mean, this is why he's in trouble. Kyrios is the word for Lord that he uses for Jesus. This is edgy, dangerous, subversive. He's like a leader of the underground movement. If we could go back there, he's edgy and dangerous, saying Jesus is king. Dangerous, edgy, Kyrios, he's the king. Wow. So this is treason. He's an enemy of the state. You know, we use the phrase kingdom of God, but I wonder if we should kind of think in terms of country of God. Because as Americans, we don't know how kingdoms work. We're Americans. We're part of a democracy and a republic. The word democracy is actually never found in the Constitution, which is kind of funny. But anyways, we're basically a democracy and a republic. And what's fascinating to me is this. When we talk about the kingdom of God, we don't really know what that means because we're not from England or something. We don't have a czar. We don't have a king. We don't have a monarch. We don't have an autocratic dictator, leader of a small island that we're living on. What does it mean? Well, it means country of God. This is a God-run country. So imagine if you said, and this is way more euphemized even today. It was so much more hyperbolic and exaggerated in Paul's day. But imagine we said, you know, everyone's like debating, is Trump president or is Biden president-elect? You know how like that's a huge debate right now and you got to be careful what you say because people get mad. This is the hardest time for pastors and politicians. I was reading in the news today that if you're a public leader, if you do open up for business, everyone thinks you're killing people. And if you don't open up your business, everyone thinks you're taking away their freedom. Like either way, you're in trouble. You know what I mean? I kind of like it. I like being thrown in the deep end. I became senior pastor during this season. I kind of like it. It's actually really fun. Anyways, the idea of country, imagine if Paul's like, he doesn't say Trump or Biden, he's like, President-elect Jesus Christ. You're like, did he just say that? Can he even be an American citizen? Only we don't have that kind of persecution that Paul had to the degree that Paul had, not even close in his day. He's in prison. You realize why he's writing for prison. He's an enemy of the state. This is treason. So you're like, the Lord Jesus Christ, yawn. You got to remember, this puts him in jail. And when he's writing, you are citizens not of Rome as an outpost or colony there in Philippi. You are citizens of heaven. You're like, yeah, we know why you're in prison. You're writing dangerous stuff, subversive, edgy stuff that's making you the leader of the underground movement. I was reading this book on comparative religions. There's an argument to be made that Paul was actually the founder of Christianity. It's all based on Jesus, but he's the one who spread it to Europe. In fact, Philippi is the first time the gospel came to Europe was when Paul went to Philippi. And he's the one really spreading it around the world. Jesus said Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost ends of the earth. That's what Paul's doing. Paul's spreading it to the uttermost ends of the earth. He's kind of the founder of modern day Christianity in the sense that his epistles really lay out what Acts 2:42 says is the apostles' doctrine. So this is what he writes, grace and peace. Turn with me to the left to Romans chapter 1. And please turn quickly because I am going very long. Romans chapter 1, starting in verse 1. Everyone say grace and peace. If you're there, would you say grace and peace? Okay, Romans 1, let's read quick. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated under the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Verse 5, by whom we have received grace. Everyone say grace. An apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom are ye also the called of Jesus Christ. Verse 7, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, hagios, grace to you. Everyone say grace. And peace. Everyone say peace. From God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Take a breath, Paul. He wouldn't do well on Twitter. This is more than 140 characters, I'm pretty sure. So how does he start off the letter to the Romans? Grace and peace, right? Grace and peace. He starts off saying grace and peace. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. Just, you know, 5-6 pages. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1. If you're there, say grace and peace. Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. He did have to call himself an apostle to this church. He had a strained relationship with them. Through the will of God and Sosthenes, our brother. Everybody say Sosthenes without a lisp. You failed. You can't say Sosthenes without a lisp. Sosthenes, our brother, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, both theirs and ours. Grace, everyone say grace, grace. Be unto you. And peace, everyone say peace. From God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. How does Paul start off his letter? With grace and peace. Isn't it interesting, by the way, that he calls them sanctified? He calls them sanctified. They're getting drunk on communion wine and hoarding bread at the expense of the poor. And one guy's delivered over to the synagogue of Satan because he's sleeping with his dad's wife. And Paul says, you're sanctified. We often think we are justified by grace and sanctified by works. But I love what my brother Peter John pointed out. We are justified by grace. We are sanctified by grace. We are glorified by grace. We are consoled and have consolation, glorification, sanctification, justification by grace. He calls them, I love this, sanctified. Isn't his grace amazing? Amazing grace. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Turn with me to the right, to Galatians chapter 1. Let's see how he opens up the letter to the Galatians. I'm guessing you're probably able to predict what he's going to say, right? Even if you haven't read the book. Galatians chapter 1. Are you there? Say grace and peace if you're there. Paul, that's a spoiler alert, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Kind of strange relationship with them. Had to call the circumcisers. He wished they would cut themselves off. Like, very heavy language. He's like, I'm an apostle. Listen to what I'm saying. Don't let legalists come in. That's what the book's about. And all the brethren, verse 2, which are with me unto the churches of Galatia. Here it is, verse 3. Grace be to you. Everyone say grace. Grace. And peace. Everyone say peace. From God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Turn with me to the right to 1 Timothy chapter 1. 1 Timothy chapter 1. Paul at the end of his life called himself Paul the Aged. In 2 Timothy, everyone had forsaken him. Paul writes this letter to Timothy, his first epistle. Paul, an apostle, verse 1, of Jesus Christ, by, watch this, the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. I'm so thankful he's our hope, aren't you? Unto Timothy, mine own son in the faith. Everyone say grace. Grace. Mercy and peace. Whoa, he switched it up here. Paul's quite rebellious. He switched up the systematic formula. Wow, mixes it up. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Are you getting the picture here? He's all about what? Grace and peace. He's all about grace and peace. In fact, turn with me back to Philippians. He starts, get this, don't miss this. Paul starts every one of his 13 letters with grace and peace. See, wait, I thought Paul wrote 14. Well, he might have written Hebrews, but nobody knows for sure. Paul starts every one of the 13 letters where we know for a fact he wrote with that phrase, grace and peace. Now, here's what's interesting about when he starts with grace. The usual greeting in Greek, remember Philippi was in Greece, even though it was a Roman colony, Latin inscriptions on the building, etc., buildings. Paul is using a greeting that's really clever, actually, because the way that you would greet people in Greek, the usual greeting was Karin. Everyone say Karin. Karin, Karin, everyone say Karin. It means hail or greetings. Everyone say Karin. But that's not the word he uses. He uses the word charis. Everyone say charis. Like, that catches you off guard. The subject in the email heading, the first word of the email, like, you're like, that sounds like a play on words. I don't know, I just thought of this off the top, but this is a bad example. But a lot of my friends say, what's good? Like, you pick up the phone, what's good? What's good? That's like starting out with, what's bad? You're like, you're kind of playing on the usual greeting, but you're doing something a little different there. Only Paul makes it something more hopeful. He actually doesn't say Corinne, he says Charis. And if you're hearing that in Greek, you're like, that sounds like the Greek greeting, but you switched it up a little bit. There's this parlance, there's this assonance that's similar to Corinne, but Charis, it sounds similar, but what does it mean? Charis, or you can pronounce it Charis, that's my niece's beautiful middle name, Charis. It means grace or gift. Everyone say grace or gift. That's what charis means, grace or gift. Charis is a lovely word. What does it mean? Well, here's the basic ideas in the word charis. It means joy. Everyone say joy. It contains the meaning of pleasure. Everyone say pleasure. So it's a lovely word. Basic ideas, joy, pleasure, brightness. Everyone say brightness. Beauty. Everyone say beauty. As Shay said, Christmas Eve, you got to come. It's going to be fun because you're going to have to put on your sunglasses, put on your suntan lotion because it's brightness. You're going to get bronzed with all the Christmas lights, right? That's the idea. Beauty, brightness, joy, pleasure. It's a delightful word. It is, in fact, charis, the word grace uses, is connected with the English word charm. Man, we need charm today. It's not very charming on social media these days, is it? It's not very charming talking politics at Thanksgiving, is it? It's not very charming how we interact with people who don't share our political or our faith views, isn't it? Or even people in churches fighting against each other. There's not a lot of charm. Let your words be seasoned with grace, salt, winsome, that we might win some. We need more charm. It's very similar to an ice skater. If an ice skater does these lovely figure eights, you say, wow, she's a graceful ice skater. That's the idea of grace. It can mean charming. It's a lovely word. It's our English word charm. We could use a lot more charm in our culture today. Not yelling and angry, screeching at each other. We need some charm, some charm. Now, what does grace mean? That's kind of a superficial meaning, but let's dive deeper into what does charis actually mean etymologically? Well, we gotta know because Paul uses this word charis or grace over 100 times in his letters. He uses this word grace. Everyone say over 100 times. So he uses this word a ton, over 100 times in his letters, he uses this word grace. Now, one Greek scholar defines grace as that which causes joy, pleasure, gratification, favor, and acceptance. Isn't that great? Joy, gratification, pleasure, acceptance. Isn't it great that you are accepted in the beloved? Not by good things you've done, not excluded by bad things you've done, by grace, through faith. Isn't it amazing? I think it's amazing grace. Am I the only one? Maybe you guys have it all together and you don't need any grace. Give me a little grace. Our word's so flat, but man, originally it wasn't a flat word. It was a dynamic word. It was freighted with all kinds of meaning. Do you need grace in your life? Five people. Does anyone else need grace? Grace, man. Do you know what else it's been defined as? An empowering presence of God deep inside your being. It's visceral and in your bones. It's not just God giving you like, oh, I'll give you a little grace. I'll let this one slide. The periptoma and the hamartia, sins, transgressions. We studied that in Ephesians. Oh, I'll let that slip. I'll give you a little grace. No, grace is not just something that God gives. It's something that God embodies, personifies, and then anthropomorphizes when he lives grace in you and through you. Here's what I mean. Grace is an empowering presence of God deep inside your being, so much so that it's not just a flat thing like, oh, you're accepted, not by works, which is true. It goes so much deeper than that. It's not static. It's kinetic, freighted, and even frantic with divine energy. Would you turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 to learn more about what grace is? Turn with me to the left to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to start in verse 9. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 9. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Before he was Paul the preacher, he was Saul the persecutor from Tarsus. But, verse 10. Okay, now really track with this. This is 1 Corinthians 15, verse 10. But by the, what? Grace of God, I am what I am. And his, what? Grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. 1 Corinthians 15, 10. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the what? Grace of God, which was with me. Listen to this. Let me just read it to you. Let me read to you verse 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. What is he saying? The grace of God empowered me to work harder than they all. Who? Than all the other apostles. Do you see why Paul's the one who wrote 13 books of the New Testament, not Peter, James, John, Jude, Bartholomew, Judas, Nathaniel, Matthias? Why were the three guys, the 12 guys who were with Jesus for 3.5 years during his physical public ministry, why didn't they have the impact that Paul had? I believe this gives us the answer. The grace of God actually caused Paul to outwork any of them. I didn't share this first service, but I'm going to share this right now. I love my job. I really do. I'm not saying this is really by the grace of God. I was calculating it this morning. I think I do like 80-hour weeks, probably, but it doesn't feel like it. It's like all I do because I love it. Like, I really do. I haven't taken a day off in months and months. I'm going to take a vacation in January, which will be sick. But, like, I haven't taken one in a year and a half, so I figured I probably should get, like, recharged. But, like, I really love it. Like, I was like, guys, I'm so tired. I'm getting worked ragged. I'm like, no, I like, love what I do. What is that? Can I tell you what it is? Grace. That's what Paul says. He doesn't say, I worked harder than all the other apostles because I'm a boss. He doesn't say, I worked harder than all the apostles because I'm bomb.com. People laugh when I said I just wrote two more books. I wrote each one in 3 weeks or less. They're like, why? I'm like, I don't know. I just have to. It's grace. And you know what? You have a calling. And when you're doing your calling, like, work is hard. They call it hard work for a reason. But grace empowers you to do your work. So many people think like, oh man, like the grit. And people warn me, they're like, Ben, watch out. You're going to crash. You're going to burn. I mean, I hope that's not a priestly blessing you're speaking over me, because that sounds more like a curse. But it's like, I feel great. Last night, slept great. Had fridge sleeping right next to my head all last night. My Persian cat. He just lays there, and sometimes he wakes me up with his wheezing. I just start petting him and fall back asleep. He just sleeps right next to my head all through the night. It's great. I feel great. Grace. Friends, grace isn't just, oh, I guess I'm accepted in the beloved. I'm a terrible person. What a wretch I am. No, grace is, I'm like powerful. You know those superhero movies? I didn't share this first service either. That's why this service is a lot longer. I'm sorry. Come to 9 next week. But basically, well, then nobody will be here. So come to 11 next week. Basically, you know those superhero movies, how it's always like Spider-Man, like they discover their powers. He gets bit by a spider and then like webs are, then he can lift like super powerful things. That's like what grace is. You're like an ordinary civilian, and then all of a sudden you're like, I was Saul the persecutor. Now I'm like a new creature in Christ. Like I can work harder than anybody else. That's what he says. Not I. 3 times he says grace. So grace is not just acceptance. Grace is power to work. Wow. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians, just a few pages over, chapter 8. So grace is the power to work? That's what grace is. Not just acceptance, but it's the power to work. What else is grace? Well, let's take a look. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, starting in verse 1. Moreover, brethren, we do you to wit of the grace. Everyone say grace. Of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. Where was Philippi? In Macedonia. So this was one of the generous churches. How that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy in their deep poverty, so the Philippians are joyful even though they're poor, abounded unto the riches of their liberality. They showed liberality, generosity. For to their power, verse 3, I bear record, yea, in beyond their power, they were willing of themselves, praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift. What does grace mean? It means, what does charis mean? It means grace or gift. Do you see this play on words that Paul's doing? That we would receive the gift, another meaning of grace, and take upon us the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. Fellowship can mean to share, like a business share. Financial gift is what they gave to all those hagios, the saints. Verse 5, and this they did, not as we hope, but first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God, insomuch that we desired Titus, another one of Paul's proteges, that as he had begun, so he would also finish in you the same grace. Also, that's verse 6. Remember what Philippians 1:6 says? He who has begun a good work in you will be faithful to finish it. The word grace. Remember? Grace. Grace. He who began a good work in you will be faithful to finish it. So too, he would also finish in you the same grace also that he had begun. Verse 6, verse 7. Therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge, and in all diligence and in your love to us, see that ye abound in this grace also. See that ye abound in this grace also. Let's keep reading. I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. What's he saying? The Philippians and the Macedonian churches, they're poor, and yet they're rich in their generosity and their liberality. They gave to me a gift, the other word for grace. By grace, they were generous. By grace, and I'm expecting Titus to finish the work that he had begun, just as God has begun a good work in you, he will finish it, grace and peace. This is all by grace. That Titus will finish the work also. Watch this, ye abound in everything in faith. I speak not by commandment. You know the grace of God, that though Jesus was rich? Yeah, he was rich. I haven't been to heaven, but the brochure is pretty compelling. Streets paved with gold, oh, we have so much resources, so much surplus, we'll just pave the streets with gold. That's what the resources we're gonna use. He was rich, but he became what? Poor, penniless teacher from Nazareth, that we might be rich through him. So what is the context here? He's saying by grace, the churches of Macedonia financially gave with liberality or generosity. So grace empowers you to be generous with money. Wow, that's what grace is? It's a gift. So grace is a gift, financial gift in this case. It allows you to be generous and show liberality with money. Let's go one more place, 2 Timothy. Would you go to 2 Timothy? I am going long today, guys. Hang in there. We're almost done. You guys chilling? Okay. Next week will be shorter, I think. 2 Timothy chapter 2. We're beginning our initial descent. Verse 1. Thou therefore, my son, 2 Timothy 2:1, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Sounds emphatic. You should put it on your gym wall when you're lifting weights. It sounds great, doesn't it? Be strong in the grace. But what does it mean? Sounds great, but what does it mean? Well, he tells us, verse 2, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, this same commit thou to faithful men who shall all be able to teach others also. Verse 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for mysteries, yet is he not crowned, except that he strive faithfully? I was talking to Greg Hogg afterwards. He's a wrestling coach. This is talking about wrestling when it talks about the masteries. Verse 6, the husbandman, referring to farmers, that laboreth must be first partakers of the fruits. Be strong in grace. What does it mean? It means to fight like a soldier, compete like an athlete, wake up early and plant like a farmer. That's what he's saying. He's saying, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Don't entangle yourself in the affairs of this life. Remember, you have a captain, you have a general. If you're in the Marine Corps, they don't say, oh yeah, well, like you gotta finish that level of World of Warcraft video games. Like, great, finish World of Warcraft video game, then come to training. Like, no, you come when I call. That's how God is. He's the captain of our salvation. You don't get entangled in the superfluities of this life. You please the one who called you. So endure hardness, endure hardship as a good soldier. Be strong in grace. Be like those competing in the mastery, like an athlete. Train your body. Paul said, I beat my body into submission, lest when I preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. It was said of Alexander the Great that he gave off the impression that his body was a slave. So too, Paul made his body a slave. Like, he made it do what he wanted it to do. So train like an athlete. And then he says, get up early and plant like a husbandman, like a farmer. So grace empowers you to train like an athlete. It allows you to plant early like a farmer, and it allows you to fight like a warrior. That's grace. That's grace. That's grace. The power to work, the power to give generously, the power to fight like a warrior, train like an athlete, and get up early like a farmer and plant and sow the seeds. That's grace. My favorite definition of grace. Notice this, be strong in grace. That's what it looks like. The credenda, the agenda. This is grace. Now here's what it looks like. Here's the agenda. Not just a creed, but an agenda. This is what it looks like. My favorite definition of grace comes from an early theologian named Tertullian. Lived 1,800 years ago. Early church father, church Christian theologian. Tertullian defined grace as the divine energy working in the soul. Isn't that great? That sums it up to me. The divine energy working in the soul. Grace is not out there somewhere. It's the divine energy working in the soul. It's the presence of God endowing you and bestowing upon you the power to work, to give generously, to fight like a warrior, to train like an athlete, to plant like a farmer. It's been described, grace has, as the living presence of the Creator deep inside your bones. It's poured out through His Spirit in a flood of you. Euphoric joy, transcendent peace, and it's a limitless power to be, to do, and to live up to the calling that God has pinned on your life. That's grace. Grace is not just forgiveness, it is. It's not just acceptance, you better believe it, but it's also power. Finally, peace. So charis, the divine energy working in the soul. Finally, peace. Notice what he says back in Philippians chapter 1, verse 2. Grace be unto you in peace. Friends, the divine energy working in the soul, the power to plant, to do, to be, to live up to the calling of God in your life, to fight like a soldier, to train like an athlete, to plant like a farmer, to give generously like the Macedonian churches, the grace of God which empowers you and enables you and ennobles you and equips you, the grace of God which lets you work harder than anyone else, that be unto you. And that is with you. This is a blessing, not just a benediction. Wow. Peace. Peace. You guys are making me sweat today. Is anybody awake? I love this. Are you guys good? Okay, good. Peace. Peace. Let's close with peace. Peace. What is it? Peace has been defined as harmony. Everyone say harmony. Tranquility. Say tranquility. wholeness, well-being, salvation of the total person, reconciliation of persons, and societies to God, as well as to one another. Guys, you're killing me right now. Like, we're not the Frozen Chosen. I know we live in like a movie theater America where you can watch something and then you just kind of passively, but like really participate with me. I'll just give you the last one. Peace at the deepest level. Everyone say peace at the deepest level. Okay, thank you. I love you. We're gonna be a grace and peace church, not like, grace and, I don't know. Okay, you know what I mean? Like, let's do this. Grace and peace. It is peace at the deepest level. Now, what you have to understand is Paul was trained in Tarsus, was trained by Hillel's grandson, Gamaliel, lived in Jerusalem. He wrote Greek, but he thought Hebrew. Now, he stole the germ of some Stoic ideas like Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good. Philippians 4:13, those famous verses, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Only he stole the germ of the idea from Zeno and the Stoics, but changed it from self-sufficiency to Christ, God's sufficiency. But for the most part, Paul wrote in Greek, but he thought in Hebrew. You got to get that. He wrote in Greek. He was around Tarsus with professors and sophists and scientists and stuff. But he was Hebrew deep in his bones. He was a Jew deep in his bones. So he writes Greek, but he thinks Hebrew. So the Greek word, we'll get into that in a moment, and we're closing here very quickly. The word for peace that he uses, if you translate it over to Hebrew, it's the word shalom. Remember, he's thinking Hebrew. Everyone say shalom. Shalom. It's actually a Jewish greeting to this day. Raise your hand if you've been to Israel. You've been to Israel? Well, how do they greet you? Shalom, 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 shalom. It's their greeting to this day. It's actually one word code for the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden be with you. May God restore you as Adam walked with God in the cool of the day in the garden. May you eat from the tree of life. May all be well in the world. May you live in a garden with God. That's what shalom means. It's one word code for the Garden of Eden. Now, in the Greek language, it's the word Irene. Is anybody here named Irene? Is there anybody here named Irene? Does anybody here know anybody named Irene? Raise your hand. Okay, well, that's where the word comes from, Irene. And it may well be connected with the actual Greek word Irene. And it actually means to join or weave together. So this piece has always got to do with personal relationships. Isn't that interesting? It's got to do with personal relationships. So this piece isn't just how can God fill the God-sized hole in me. That really Augustine introduced, like, you need to get your cup filled with God so you're satisfied, which is great. But originally, it wasn't that we're cups that need to be filled. It's that we're mirrors that are to be outward reflecting the image of God, his creative attributes to the world. Do you see? It's not so much consumeristic, it's more outward. Like, how can I spread the image of God, his creative attributes to the world around me? But in order to spread peace to others, you have to have peace within. How do you have peace within? Well, Philippians will tell us. I'm gonna make this point through video. I'll make one closing remark and then we'll be on our way. Philippians 4, 6 through 7, this famous verse, Paul says, be anxious for nothing. He tells us to be a non-anxious presence in the world. But in everything with prayer and thanksgiving and supplication, he goes on to write, let your requests be made known to God. And this is what he says, the peace of God, which passes understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds. Now, when he says this peace passes understanding, it doesn't primarily mean, man, I don't understand where this peace came from. It means that your understanding cannot conjure, fabricate, or manufacture this peace. It's a peace that comes from somewhere else. It's a transrational peace. It's a spiritual peace. In other words, you cannot think your way into peace. Peace has to bypass your understanding. In other words, you have to trust in the Lord with all of your heart and not lean on your own understanding. And that's when a peace that bypasses understanding, Paul says, will guard your heart and your mind. Now, that word guard in Greek is used of a prison sentinel that would literally guard a cell or guard a prisoner to make sure the prisoner couldn't escape. Paul said we're to take our thoughts captive, and these captive thoughts of anxiety, stress, and worry, the peace of God will actually guard our hearts to make sure those thoughts are taken captive and they can't escape, so we'll be left with peace. So I want to encourage you to continue to talk to God about your fears, your worries, your anxieties, and thank him for all he's done, and this peace will guard your heart and bypass your understanding. grace and peace. You need inner peace to spread peace outwardly to the world around you. As I close, when Paul puts these two words together, grace and peace, he was doing something incredibly fantastical and wonderful. He was taking the normal greeting phrases of two great nations and molding them into one. These nations didn't get along. Charis, which is the word he uses for grace, is the greeting with which Greek letters always begin, with a slight twist, Kareen, but charis, that idea. And then Irene was the greeting with which Jews met each other, shalom. So what he's doing is he's taking shalom and Irene, peace, the greeting of peace from the Israel nation, and then he's using the word grace, kareen, charis, from the Greek nation, and he puts them together. Because Paul was called an apostle to the Gentiles, even though he came from a Jewish background. And what he did can change the world. Because if you were not a Greek, you were called a barbarian. Everything you said sounded like barbarian. It's onomatopoeia. And Greeks or Gentiles were considered fuel for the fires of hell to many in Israel. And yet Paul takes one greeting from grace, another from Israel, smashes them together and speaks it over this church, which was mainly Gentile, but had a few Jews scattered in. The barbarians, the Jews, the Greeks, the Gentiles, were at each other's throat. And through one greeting, Paul brings them together. What if, as Applegaters, we brought people together across the aisle from different denominations? We're all one big church, meet in many different locations, in Medford, Gray, everywhere. But we came together. What if we looked like a church that was known for grace and peace? So we write flat in America for the most part today, but back in the day there were layers, like a Labrador spar. You turn it over and over again and you see more there that you didn't know. It's not just that Paul says grace and peace. The very act of his writing it was an act of grace and peace, because he took one from the Greeks, one from the Israelis. They hated each other, Gentiles and Jews, and he put them together. He's like, well, wait, you can't put us in the same sentence. You know that phrase, like, that person should not be in the same sentence as this other guy. Like, people who love Jordan and hate, you know, LeBron, they're like, LeBron and Kobe, MJ shouldn't even be put in the same sentence. That's this. The Greeks and the Israelis shouldn't even be put in the same sentence, and yet Paul takes the Greeks, Charis, Kareen, the Hebrew, Irene, Shalom, puts them in one sentence, and he's putting them together. So may we spread grace and peace, and may we actually live it and put wheels on it. You're going to meet with some people during the holidays who are going to drive you crazy. You're going to want to commit homicide at Walmart during Christmas shopping. You're going to want to grab your family members by the neck for embarrassing you in front of everybody during Christmas. You're going to see that crazy uncle that you haven't seen in a year. Hit me that I'm a crazy uncle. But you're going to see that uncle and you're like, oh gosh. You're going to see posts on Facebook that's going to make your hackles rise. You're going to get that email in your inbox. But what if everything started with grace and peace? Before we start World War III or another civil war or see a church divided, what if we were about grace and peace? Who would have known a simple greeting might just change the world? Let's pray. Father, I pray grace and peace over this church. Thank you so much for these joyful people. Help them to continue to abound in work, in training, in fighting, in metaphorical farming, in generosity. And I pray that we would have this dynamic divine energy at work in our soul, as Tertullian said, that we would be a people of grace. We'd be a people of peace. In Jesus' name, would you stand with me? The Lord bless thee and keep thee and make his face shine upon thee and give thee peace, grace, mercy, and peace.
Hey Hope Generators, make sure to smash that like button below. You can hit subscribe so you make sure to be notified whenever we have new videos right up there. And then you can watch our next video so you can be empowered to be a hope dealer by clicking this box right here. I love you guys, and until next time, may the hope be with you.